Very special thanks to My Next Car in Bedfordshire for providing the Ram in this review, and as you can kind of tell from the vehicle in question, they have some pretty specialised stuff for sale, so if you do want to check out their stock, and of course it changes pretty often with the kind of stuff that they're selling, then check out the link right below this video in the description if you are in that part of the UK and in the market for something like this. '22 has already been an amazing year for me within the Beards and Cars series because I've already ticked off three of my literal bucket list vehicles that I wanted to review for the entire channel, and this is one of them. The Ram SRT10 is legitimately one of my dream vehicles in this exact form, the quad cab. That's the four-door version for the uninitiated, and there are some things about the SRT10 which even existing fans might not know. As I alluded to in the thumbnail though, I believe this is a flawed diamond. A diamond, but certainly not a perfect one. And don't worry for my American viewers, and I know there are plenty of you on the channel, probably especially for an episode like this, this is not a classic Clarkson rags on American cars for no apparent reason rant. I love American cars, especially classics, but modern stuff as well, and as I said, this has always been a favourite of mine. In fact, on paper, the idea is genius. You take one of the most iconic performance engines ever built, and in my opinion, one of the best performance engines ever built, the Viper V10, and then you put it into a brilliant workhorse of a truck, a massively popular one as well, the Ram. And on a slight side note, for me personally, I happen to think this is the best looking generation of Ram, but maybe that's just me. Now, they haven't done this since, and of course they never did it before, but for this generation, from around 2004 to 2006, they produced two different variants with some special editions as well, but two overarching variants of the Ram SRT10. The first introduced was the single cab, that's the two-door version, and interestingly, that was only available with a manual, a 6-speed gearbox. Then, due to that vehicle's success, they introduced this one, my preferred version with the extra space, the extra doors, and the extra practicality, the 5-seater SRT10 quad cab. Now this one, curiously, is only available with an auto gearbox, but strangely, it's a 4-speed auto. And for those who don't know, that 4-speed auto is actually a 48RE unit, which comes from the Cummins diesel engine Ram. So in other words, it literally is a workhorse gearbox, which they've dropped into a sport truck. And that leads to my problem. See, on paper, this vehicle ticks every single box of something that you would want from a vehicle like this. It is quite deliberately crazy. And Dodge, of course, has a knack for doing that. The Viper, the Ram SRT10, more recently the Hellcats, the Demons, etc. They love making them, people love buying them, and I love plenty of them. They are crazy vehicles in the best ways. However, the number one thing that I would recommend you need to bear in mind before you even get the chance to drive a Ram SRT10, be it the manual or the auto, but especially this one with that auto, you must have the right expectations when driving this. Because I'll be honest, my first thoughts after driving it were actually a little bit of disappointment, and the reason why was due to my expectations. And I wouldn't say they were unjustified either. See, when you hear the idea of a, especially single cab, so it's smaller and a bit lighter, fitted with this iconic, massive 505 cubic inch or 8.3 litre naturally aspirated V10, no turbos, no supercharger, putting out 500 horsepower and 525 pound-feet of torque, which is well over 700 newton meters. Well, you have a certain expectation of what that's going to be like. And regardless of the vehicle's size and weight, and the Touareg V10 is a prime example of this, you can have a huge amount of fun in a car which is big, but also performance-oriented. That's the thing though. this feels way more like a workhorse than it does a performance truck. Now, of course, with me driving this variation, I have no doubt that the single cab with lower weight, better performance, and the manual is probably more of what you would want from a Ram SRT10 experience. But this one would, as I said, have still been my option were I to buy one, and so I'm glad this is the one I got the chance to drive. Now, I would say with those expectations in mind, wherein you should absolutely not expect this to be some tail sliding, V10 howling, screaming monster of a car, which it simply isn't, what you need to expect is actually something which ironically has more the kind of performance which you'd expect from that Cummins diesel. It's effortless, for sure, especially with 525 pound-feet of torque going through a 4-speed auto, the performance is the definition of lazy. In fact, cruising at 60 miles an hour, the engine is barely turning 800 RPM. Yeah, really, that's nuts. I mean, that's literally like idle speed for the engine. And yet, when you put your foot down, there's no ceremony to it. It's quick, it gets going, and it makes more noise, but it doesn't have that visceral kind of explosive performance, which you would arguably expect it to have. And for those saying, well, what are you talking about? It's a big 2.5-ton pickup truck, what do you expect? Well, actually, I've driven a couple of other huge vehicles on the channel with a similar kind of weight. I mentioned my own Touareg V10. That has no way near the power of this, about 350 horsepower in the case of mine with a remap, but more torque, weighs even more at nearly 3 tons, and of course I've driven the Range Rover SVR, which also weighs up around the 2.5-ton mark and has a 500 horsepower Jag engine. Both of those feel far more visceral and more explosive when you really put your foot down. This feels, as I said, completely effortless. It's a beautifully lazy engine, and it's all the better for it in that way, but to me it's almost like Dodge put all of their effort into the engine, and barely any into the rest of the car. And when I say barely any, I don't mean the rest of the car is bad, I mean it essentially just feels like they took a diesel Ram, took the diesel out, dropped a Viper engine in, and just sold it like that. It doesn't feel like the rest of the truck is really up to the standard of coping with that kind of engine and performance. Now, with that being said, I could just be wrong. I could be the outlier here, because Evo magazine here in the UK put a Ram SRT10 on their test course, and they actually found it to be quicker than a Renault Clio V6 around the track, so clearly the performance is there. But I believe they were driving the manual, which is, as I said, smaller, lighter, etc. Now, this one is slower. The manual does 0-60 in 4.9, which is properly quick. This does it in 5.3, which is still very, very fast for what it is, and the top end speed at the time was the fastest pickup out there, at around 155 miles an hour, and again, this auto version is just a little bit slower at about 147. So, in other words, more than quick enough for a truck. The problem is, in my opinion, three things in particular, at least for the quad cab. Number one is the gearbox. Number two is the suspension, and number three is the exhaust. The engine has no problems at all. The practicality has no issue. It's huge, it's spacious, it's certainly comfortable, it's super practical. Ridiculously big for UK roads, but practical. It certainly has more space than you would ever really need. However, the reason why those things let it down, well, I've kind of already touched on the gearbox. You could arguably drop a maybe better auto into it, like a 6 or 7 speed that could cope with the torque, and the performance would be much more explosive simply by doing that. That is a fairly hefty job to do though, so it's not for everyone. Things which you could do though would be, i.e. the suspension. Now, the suspension is another way in which it's just not up to the task. It's super comfortable, it's great for being a cruiser, but it just doesn't have the kind of poise and the kind of tightness that you would want from something with a Viper engine. This is the kind of truck that needs to feel like you can throw it into a corner, and it just belies its size and weight, like the aforementioned Touareg and Range Rover. They are both capable of that, which proves that it can be done. So an uprated suspension setup is, I would say, essential if you're gonna get a Ram SRT10. This one, for example, has been lowered, but it still has that original kind of softness. Maybe even anti-roll bars, stuff like that, might be worth looking into. More powerful brakes are never a bad idea, although I will say the standard brakes on this one do a good job already. And the exhaust is more of a personal preference thing, because to me, and this is mostly due to that really lazy 4-speed gearbox, because the revs are always kept so low, at least in regular drive mode, you never get to hear it actually sound like a V10. It kind of just sounds like a really big V8, which is a nice sound, but it doesn't sound like a Viper, and it certainly doesn't howl like one. It was always a curious choice to me to make this a little twin pipe exhaust at the back. It just kind of looks odd. I mean, if there was ever a vehicle that was justified in having a side exit pipe, it's a Ram SRT10. I mean, the Viper already has it. But it's these smaller things. Like I said, a flawed diamond. I think the concept is sound. The concept is brilliant, and there's, let's be honest, really no one else that's done something quite like this. But it's these smaller things which you as a potential owner might want to invest in, because I promise you this, if you bought either a single cab, or especially this one, because in this softer, bigger car you'll see even better results, if you were to invest in, once you purchase it, fitting it with harder, more toned suspension and more powerful brakes, maybe a louder exhaust, but that's a personal preference thing, that is going to make a world of difference. It's going to take it from a really fast workhorse, which is what it feels like, and there's nothing inherently wrong with that, to being an actual super sport truck, which is, I would argue, what you're expecting when you go into driving it. So overall, that is my biggest caution. I do love this truck in concept. In practice, it is by no means a bad truck, and I would not categorize it as a bad experience in any sense. I did enjoy it a lot. It's just so different to what you're expecting it to feel like, at least for me, that you need to have those expectations. Not so much measured, but more realigned to a completely different kind of performance approach. You're expecting visceral, over-the-top performance. What you actually get is more like a big, huge, lazy V10 diesel like a Volkswagen Touareg would have, ironically. So in that way, of course, it appeals to me. But for a Ram potential owner who loves the Viper engine and wants that kind of experience, you could easily be disappointed if you go in expecting the wrong thing. Overall, on UK roads, it is massive. I would not say it's too big, actually, because let's be honest, we have plenty of shipping lorries on the road and they do just fine, and this isn't as big as that. So if it's too big for a certain driver, there's nothing wrong with that. For me, I like the size of it. I like bigger cars anyway. Most of the cars that I've owned have been larger. The only issue I had with actually driving it was that it was left-hand drive. This is actually the first left-hand drive car I've ever driven for full exposure, and I didn't find it difficult per se, but I will say that in something that's basically 8 feet wide, you really need to remember to stick to your lane, because my mind kept wanting me to return to where my line of sight would usually be, and if you do that, I'm going to push someone straight off the road, or ram them off the road, we could say. Ultimately, that's it for my thoughts on the SRT10. I'm still glad it was a bucket list vehicle for me though, and in many ways it ticks all of the boxes in practice. In some ways, I'd say it almost feels more like a work in progress, like Dodge had a good idea, a little gem, a little pearl, but it just needs polishing a bit more, maybe by some aftermarket kits, maybe by private owners, but the potential is certainly there. If you are an owner of one of these, or if you used to be, of course drop your stories, recommendations, warnings, experiences down below. And until next time, I'll see you then. But for now, as always, thanks for watching.